All right. Good evening, respected jury and delegates. My name is Anna Mary Jose, and my co-moderator Kaushik and I welcome you with pride to MedInvate 2020 paper presentation session. I'd like to start off by introducing our esteemed panel of judges. Our first judge is Dr. Rodrigo Antonio Brandão Neto, who is live with us from Brazil. He is an emergency and internal medicine specialist, medical director of the Emergency Department of Hospital das Clínicas, University of São Paulo, medical director of the Emergency Medicine Residency Program, and a PhD in medical sciences. He's the co-author of the book, Practical Approach to Emergency Medicine, and has multiple publications under his name. We are honored and humbled to have you with us today, sir.
Thank you. It's an honor. It's my pleasure.
Our next judge is Dr. Digumarti V.S. Sudhakar, a scientist in the Department of Gamete Immunobiology. He works with ICMR National Institute for Research in Reproductive Health. His areas of work concern functional characterizing of novel male infertility genes in mouse models, testis-specific histones modifications, genomic loci associated with testis-specific histones, and microtubule dynamics role in sperm motility. He has a PhD in medical genetics at CSIR, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, Hyderabad. He's also a postdoctoral research associate at the same. He has plenty of awards to his name, as well as stellar publications under his sleeve. Welcome, sir, to MedInvate 2020. We are honored to have you with us today.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the introduction.
Our next judge in our panel is Dr. Arun Kumar Annamalai, a family medicine physician, public health scientist, and epidemiologist working with ICMR, National Institute of Epidemiology. He is the Director of Clinical Research for ARCA Research Private Limited, Head of Clinical Strategy Lamarck Biotech Private Limited. He is also the founder and CEO of LaMed Labs and Deep Medicine Labs India. He's an expert in clinical validation of drugs, devices, diagnostics, vaccines, and informatics. He is also an expert in clinical artificial intelligence and a specialist in telepsychiatry, psychiatric epidemiology, computational psychiatry, and psychiatric research. In addition to the string of achievements, he is also a published author. Thank you, sir, for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for the introduction.
Before we begin with this session, I'd like to familiarize you with the rules. Participants have to share their screens, and in the occasion you're unable to do so, we will share your presentations for you. If you're unable to get connected, you will be allowed to present at the end of the session. The presenting participant has to keep their video and audio on. Participants requested to keep their audio. You will have 5 minutes to present your study. And after 4 minutes, a reminder will be sent. You will be interrupted and asked to stop your presentation. The presentation will be followed by a 3-minute question and answer session with the jury. I would like to call forward Kaushik to begin the session.
Thanks, Anna, for such a sweet introduction. So this is Kaushik here, and I welcome the judges as well as the participant to the MedInvate 2020 research paper presentation finals. So hope everyone is safe and secure. And I request the participants to stay calm and cool in the entire session. So from my side, I wish all the participants a good luck. So to begin with, the first participant of the session, Aiva Sabu. Is that Aiva Sabu there?
Yes, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. So you can now unmute yourself and you can share your screen.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt. Before starting the session, I would once again particularly highlight this point. Respected judges, we are very short of time. So we have allotted the 5 minutes for the presentation and the 3 minutes for the question and answer session. So the three questions from the three judges for the span of 1 minute. So if the question and answer by the delegate is is over soon, you can ask the second question, but make sure how many questions by how many judges. So we should end the discussion session within 3 minutes after the presentation. Thank you so much. And one more point, as I informed judges, please note the name of the participant. Like suppose Aiva Sabu, you can enter one Aiva, and you can score based on the things which we have provided you. Thank you so much, and all the best to the participants.
Can I start?
Yes, you can start.
My study is on the topic new onset of atrial fibrillation and its determinants in a multidisciplinary critical care unit. Atrial fibrillation is one of the commonest arrhythmia seen in critically ill patients or patients admitted to the intensive care unit. The prevalence has been found to be about 10 to 65% in patients after a cardiac surgery and 4.5 to 15% in a patient admitted to the general ICU and about 46% in patients with sepsis. Age, comorbidities, vasopressor support, and interventions like central venous catheter or renal replacement therapy are some of the non-risk factors of atrial fibrillation. So we have conducted a study with two main objectives. The first objective is to determine the incidence of atrial fibrillation, and the second is to determine the risk factors associated with the new onset of atrial fibrillation. So here we conducted a nested case control study in the patients admitted to the ICU of a tertiary care teaching hospital in Kerala for a time period of 2 months. The inclusion criteria was adult critically ill patients of the both gender. And exclusion criteria include patients with non-arrhythmia episodes in the past. We used a structured questionnaire to collect the data from the ICU, after which frequency, percentage, incidence, and odds ratio with 95% confidence interval was being calculated. Multiple logistic regression analysis was done to find the risk factors associated with atrial fibrillation. So results, in our study, we surveyed about 272 people and one patient was being excluded due to a known case of AF. So the incidence of getting a new onset of atrial fibrillation was found to be 10.7%. That is, out of the whole group, 29 people had a new onset of atrial fibrillation. And out of these 29 people, 14 had recurrent episode, that is 11 had a single episode of recurrence and 3 had more than one episode of recurrence. The potential risk factors that we took into consideration was gender, age, abusive habits, comorbidities, organ failure, electrolyte disturbance, and supports given. And out of which, organ failure, that is respiratory system failure and kidney failure, electrolyte disturbances like low potassium and low calcium levels, supports like vasopressor support, renal replacement therapy, central venous catheter, a diuretic support, and poor left ventricular function were significant risk factors of atrial fibrillation. After which we built a multiple logistic regression model using those factors which had a significant odds ratio in univariate analysis. So here we found that those patients who were on renal replacement therapy possess a risk of 4.7 times, and those who had low potassium levels possessed 3.9 times, and those who were on a vasopressor support had a risk of 2.9 times of getting atrial fibrillation when all other conditions remained same for both the patient groups. Discussion. In a recent review article by Margatti, the prevalence of atrial fibrillation was found to be 4.5 to 15% in ICU, which was similar to our study, which has an incidence of 10.7%. In the Rotterdam study, low levels of serum potassium was associated with higher risk of atrial fibrillation. And this association was independent of several potential confounders. And our results also showed a similar pattern. Jonathan et al. In their systemic review concluded that vasopressor as a contributor of atrial fibrillation in critically ill patients, which also supports our finding. A study based on Taiwan National Health Insurance Research Database says that there were higher events of atrial fibrillation among the dialysis patient, which also supports our finding. Conclusion. Since lower levels of potassium was an independent risk factor in our study, regular monitoring of potassium levels and prompt treatment can reduce the chance of getting new onset of atrial fibrillation in ICU. But other independent risk factors like a vasopressor support and renal replacement therapy The predisposing factors must be investigated further to prevent the new onset of atrial fibrillation in ICU. References. Thank you.
Well, that was an indeed a good presentation, Ivor Sabu. So let's move on to the question and answer session. Dr. Rodrigo, do you have any questions for her?
Oh, yes. First place, I want to congratulate you for the presentation. Interesting work. You say it's a case control study, but you collect the data prospectively. I am correct?
Yes, it is a nested case control study. The case control part is that we are comparing those patients with AF with those without AF and then finding out various proportion of risk factors associated with these. So we are starting from the outcome, that is a disease, which several studies have done whose outcome is death. And then we are looking for the exposure part, that is the risk factors like electrolyte imbalance, etc. Longitudinal part is that we are finding out the incidence of the atrial fibrillation.
Okay. You're not using medical records. It was actively searching for the etiologies of atrial fibrillation. Is that what happens?
We mainly look for the risk factors.
Okay. Another question, vasopressor also in the multivariate analysis have a role in the atrial fibrillation. Do you specify for which vasopressor, if it was dopamine or noradrenaline?
No, we didn't specify. We took all of them as a single group vasopressor.
Okay.
Dopamine and epinephrine can causes changes in the heart rate, which can in turn predispose to atrial fibrillation. So we as such took hold of the group.
Okay, but you not analyze dopamine versus epinephrine in this group?
No, all of them were taken as a group. There were some patients who were on dopamine and some other patient who were on epinephrine.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Dr. Sudhakar, do you have any questions, sir?
Very simple one. So what is the age groups? And is there any specific
study? Mainly 60 to 75 age group. Most of the people were under 60 to 75 age group, but since the sample size was some small, we were not, this data did not become significant.
Yes, that's the point I'm trying to raise. So what do you suggest for a prospective study or future study? So what do you
An early detection of these risk factors can improve the outcome of the patient, mainly by reversing the atrial remodeling and preventing the complication like stroke or any other cardiovascular adverse events. So an early detection of risk factors could prevent, even before when we clinically manifest atrial fibrillation, if we find out the risk factors, we could prevent the onset of atrial fibrillation.
Dr. Sudhakar, is that the question over?
I'm done. You can proceed.
Dr. Arun Kumar, your question?
Yes. Hi, Ivor. Good presentation. I have only one question from the research design part. I'm still not able to understand in what way this is a case control study and how it was nested.
Because it is a case control study within a longitudinal study. That is a longitudinal here means cohort study. But it is not actually a cohort study because we are not in a cohort study. From the outcome, we are looking from the disease part, we are looking for the outcome, that is death or any other complication. While in case control study here, we are starting from the outcome, that is disease, that is atrial fibrillation. And then we are looking for the risk factors like electrolyte imbalance or any interventions, etc.
Okay, so what was the control here?
Those without atrial fibrillation, those patients without atrial fibrillation.
So were they matched?
Means?
Okay, skip that. And like, how did you nest them? What was the nesting done here?
Because we have two main objectives. First one is the incidence part. So incidence part along with the risk fact, finding out the risk factors. It became an nested.
Okay. Thanks, Aiva. Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And thank you, Aiva Sabu. That was indeed a good presentation. So you can quit your screen. So let's move on to the next participant. Deepthi, are you there? Deepthi? Is that Deepthi over there? Okay. So the next participant, Jangala Sai Vihar. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm there. Am I audible?
Okay. Yeah. So Jangala Sai Vihar will be presenting on the topic, a descriptive study to assess the association of geriatric score with observed chemotoxicity in cancer patients older than 60. And he's from AFMC Pune. So you can start the presentation.
Okay, is it visible? Great, I'm starting. Good evening, everyone. This is Sai Vihar, and I'm going to present my study on the topic descriptive study to assess the association of geriatric score with the observed chemotoxicity in elder cancer patients. Most of the cancer-related morbidity and cancer-related mortality occurs in elderly, but there seems to be a bias against administering chemotherapy in elderly patients because the dosage is reflexively decreased in elderly cancer patients as compared to the stage-matched younger patients. This is because oncologists are concerned about the capacity of the elderly patient to tolerate the treatment. So in order to make better treatment decisions, a toxicity prediction score is needed. So the aims and objectives are to determine geriatric functional status by means of a geriatric assessment and to correlate predicted toxicity score with the observed toxicity score. Coming to the methodology, the study type is a descriptive, non-experimental, qualitative pilot study. And the study population included 50 eligible cancer patients aged 60 years and above who were scheduled to receive chemotherapy for the first time at the daycare center, Command Hospital, Pune. And this was done for a duration of 4 months. Before the beginning of chemotherapy, the patients underwent a preliminary assessment using a geriatric assessment tool that captures various domains like a functional status, nutritional status, etc. After that, patients' pre-therapy toxicity score was noted down by using a validated tool that consisted of various variables, and the risk scores were allotted, where highest risk was given to those patients who scored between the 10 to 19 points. So this is the prediction model and the scoring algorithm given, where various variables like age, cancer type, treatment plan, and geriatric questions are given, and accordingly scores were allotted. After that, the patient was followed from the beginning to the end of cycle, 6 cycles. Toxicity were noted after each clinical encounter, that is at the end of each cycle, and were graded according to the toxicities, where grade 5 is fatal, grade 3 means severe or requires hospitalization. So to summarize the methodology, first the geriatric assessment was taken, then the toxicity prediction score. After that, the toxicity were observed at the end of each cycle for 6 cycles, and at the end, correlation was done. Coming to the methodology, 0.05 was accepted alpha error, and Pearson's coefficient was used as a degree of correlation. So I have presented the result in 4 categories. First comes the patient's characteristics. Mean age of participants was 66 years and the standard deviation 4.6. 36% were female, 64% were male. Majority of the cancer patients were suffering from lung cancer, and most of them were stage 4. Coming to the geriatric or preliminary assessment which was done, this is the mean scores of all the domains and is represented here. The mean scores of all the domains, the functional status, comorbidity, social activity, social support, and their respective mean, median, standard deviation are represented here. So the main result, the risk prediction toxicity score was found out to be 7.24, and 24% of the total cancer patient taken in the study showed high risk for toxicity. Coming to the observed toxicity, which was done after the follow-up, at least one grade 3 to 5 toxicity was occurred in 30%, and most frequent hematological toxicity was leukocytosis. Most frequent non-hematological was fatigue. So these are the non-hematological toxicity where anemia, leukocytosis, neutropenia, and thrombocytopenia are noted. And these are the non-hematological toxicities where fatigue was a major issue for the patients. The correlation between predicted toxicity and observed toxicity was shown, but it is not shown with IADR and KPS. So discussion, this study confirms that risk of chemotherapy toxicity is higher in adults. Comorbid conditions are to be identified before the start of treatment, which is done with the geriatric assessment. The prediction tool performed better than the other IADL and KPS, which is used as standard prediction tool in our clinical settings. This being a pilot study had a limited sample size, but this shows that the assessment can be done and is doable in the tertiary care center. So to conclude, the prediction model is easy to use and is feasible to incorporate in a daily practice, which enables the oncologist to better assess the risk-benefit ratio and to adjust the treatment accordingly. These are the references. Thank you.
Okay, that was a good presentation. So let's come to the question and answer session. Dr. Rodrigo, you have any questions?
Yes, a very interesting study. Two questions. This score that you use already was used for in this kind of situation, or kind of new?
Thank you for your question, sir. Sir, the prediction tool used in my study, the study which I presented, was already done in a European setting by the Harian et al. But it is never tried in our Indian setting. So as it is a short and can be done at a bedside, which is more reliable, so I have tried to do in our Indian setting and it has shown correlation. The standard tool which we use in our setting is KPS and IADL, which is generally non-specific for younger and elder. So this is specific for elder patients.
Okay. Okay. And other thing, maybe you can answer me. There was some Karnofsky score that you stop chemotherapy predicting the study or no?
Thank you for your question, sir. Sir, in my study, generally 70 to 100 is the range of normal Karnofsky performance score. If in our clinical setting, anyone with less than 70, they were not given chemotherapy. But in this study, everyone above the 70 were considered not chemotherapy. Even they were considered above 70, they were showing some chemotherapy toxicity, which shows that KPS is not a good prediction tool. The prediction tool which is done here is better than KPS.
Okay, congratulations. This is an elegant study. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Sudhakar, do you have any questions?
Yeah, I'll try to keep it very simple as a layman. So for different types of malignancies, did you observe, I think the sample number is small, but do you think there will be differences according to the type of malignancy and the type of the drug of choice of the chemotherapy that is given to the patient in the first group?
Yes, sir. Thank you for your question, sir. Sir, this is the limitation of my study. Because it's a pilot study and it has a very small sample size, I could not have all the cancer-specific toxicities. For example, if there's a myocarditis, that's a chemotherapy-related toxicity. It might be specific for other cancer. So I haven't included in this study. I've just included the non-specific toxicities. So this is my limitation of the study. So cancer-specific toxicity were not considered, which is one of the limitations. So I'll try.
Yeah, go ahead. So what do you, just a simple one. So what do you think if the toxicity score is high? So how do you guide the patient or counsel the patient? So you ask him to go to chemo?
No, sir. Sir, if the toxicity score is very high, if it's between 10 and 12, the risk shows very high, I'll tell him to wait for some time and I'll tell him to come back again to see the toxicity score again. If he shows an improvement, then I'll give chemotherapy. If he does not show an improvement, then we'll try for other modalities of treatment other than chemotherapy.
Okay, good. Nice.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And Dr. Arun Kumar, do you have a question?
Yeah, one question. What was the median toxicity score, Sai? Because you had mentioned the mean. What was the median?
Yes, sir, median toxicity score, I haven't mentioned in the slide. It's in my... calculate, but not mentioned.
Because for studies like this, it's more median makes more sense than mean. That's one thing. And another suggestion is your study design is not qualitative. It's non-experimental quantitative.
Yes, sir. Thank you for your question, sir. Sir, I have considered it as qualitative because I was doing a geriatric assessment over here, which is totally a qualitative base where I have considered all the following domains, function, status, comorbidities and all. And here I've considered toxicity, so I've included in the qualitative study, sir. But I'll make sure I'll do the changes.
Yeah, yeah, fine. Okay, that's all.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, Jangla Sai Vihar, for your presentation.
You.
So let me call the next participant. Joel, are you there?
Hello, I'm audible.
Jangla, you can quit your presentation. Joel, you're there? Yeah, you're audible, but your connection seems... Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, you're audible.
Hello? One minute. Is my presentation visible?
Oh, wait for.
Is my presentation visible?
No, actually. Okay, here is Joel alias Saji. He is presenting on the topic effect of implementation of serial procalcitonin measure on antimicrobial therapy in critically ill. He's from Believers Church Medical College, Kerala. Yeah, you are audible.
Hello, sir. Is my PPT visible?
Yes, visible.
So, good evening. The molecule that you see on your screen is C153H228N40O47S3. This is procalcitonin, a biomarker that can see in the way we look into antibiotics. There's alarming 80 million new sepsis cases reported each year worldwide, with mortality ranging between 30 to 50%. Early diagnosis and prompt antimicrobial therapy is crucial for the treatment of sepsis in order to save lives. Biomarkers can serve as a helpful tool in the judicial use of antimicrobial for sepsis. Procalcitonin, an amino acid precursor to calcitonin, is released as a component of inflammatory cascade in response to endotoxin released during bacterial infection. Therefore, PCT levels are selectively elevated in patients with bacterial infection can be used as a biomarker. Procalcitonin occurs 2 to 4 hours of active bacterial infection in 8 to 4 hours. Moreover, PCT is stable in serum samples and the results are available within 2 to 4 hours, which make it potentially useful for daily practices. Therefore, procalcitonin monitoring along with clinical picture can be used to guide antimicrobial initiation and de-escalation of bacteremia, reducing unnecessary antimicrobial exposure. My objectives were to compare the proportion of patients suspected sepsis for de-escalation of antimicrobial therapy before and after implementation of regular monitoring of PCT as a marker, and to compare the average time taken to de-escalate antimicrobial therapy for patients suspected sepsis before and after implementation of PCT as a marker, and to compare the average duration of ICU among patients suspected sepsis before and after implementation of PCT as a marker. My type of study was a cohort study. Study site was MDCC of tertiary care teaching hospital. Study period was for 4 months. Study sample were all patients admitted with MDCC suspected sepsis on antimicrobial 2 months before the implementation of PCT and 2 months after the implementation of PCT. PCT was implemented in January 2020. Sample size estimated number as per the hospital statistics 150 in each group. Inclusion criteria, all adult patients admitted to MDCC with suspected sepsis and on antimicrobials. Exclusion criteria, post-operative patients, patients on pancreatitis, trauma patients, and burn patients. My outcomes were to compare the proportion of sepsis patients who were de-escalated before discharge from ICU, average time to de-escalation of antimicrobials, and average ICU days. De-escalation was defined as either a switch of switch to an aerospectrum agent or to reduction in number of antibiotics or the earliest arrest of antibiotic treatment. Statistical analysis proportion average standard deviation was calculated to describe the data. Test proportion was done to compare the proportion de-escalated, and student status was done to compare the average duration of antimicrobial therapy in two groups. Ethics committee approval was made before the study. These are my results. This table depicts the baseline characters of my study population. The baseline characters came out to be very similar, which was an added advantage to the study. Male gender was 66.67% in the pre-implementation group and 64% in the post-implementation group. Looking into comorbidities, 24% in the pre-implementation group and 27.3% in the post-implementation group had diabetes mellitus. Now, SOFA score was 8.5 plus or minus 1.3 standard deviation in the pre-implementation and 8.5 plus or minus 1.4 in the post-implementation group. This is the pie chart depicting the source of sepsis in both the study population. Lung was the major source of sepsis in both the population, followed by skin and soft tissue. This is a box plot depicting the mean PCT values in the post-implementation group. The value showed a decreasing trend. This is the pie chart depicting the most common antibiotics that were used in the critically ill patient. Vancomycin and meropenem were the most commonly used antibiotics. The following table depicts the outcomes of the study population. You can clearly see that the proportion of patients de-escalated has increased post-implementation of PCT. That is from 61.33% to 83.33%. what's the time to de-escalation are reduced from 4.7 plus or minus 1.4 days in the pre-implementation to 3.04 plus or minus 0.8 days in the post-implementation group. The duration of ICU stays has also decreased from 5.1 plus or minus 2.1 days to 3.08 plus or minus 0.91 days. This is a Kaplan-Meier curve depicting the rate of de-escalation. The rate of de-escalation was significantly faster during the post-implementation of PCT. The de-escalation occurred 2 days earlier for at least 50% of the people during the post-implementation period. This is a box plot depicting the distribution of ICU days spent in the ICU. You can clearly see there is almost 2 day decline in the post-implementation period. Antibiotic resistance is rising to dangerously high levels in all parts of the world. New resistant mechanisms are emerging and spreading globally, threatening our ability to treat common infectious diseases. Biomarkers can act as a useful tool to early de-escalation of antibiotics. Procalcitonin precursor is just to be a fairly specific marker for severe bacterial infection in patients with specific suspected sepsis. In our study, we found that the proportion of de-escalation during ICU stay was higher after implementation of PCT in the post-implemented group than the pre-implementation group. Also, the duration of antibiotic exposure was lesser in the PCT implemented group. The time to de-escalation was 3.04 plus or minus 0.83 days in the PCT group compared to 4.7 plus or minus 1.4 days in the pre-implemented group. The number of ICU days has also come down. Study conducted by Hostreet et al. Also showed a decreased duration of antibiotic exposure in the PCT guided group compared to the controls. Study done by Dijong et al. And Ober et al. Also showed decreased duration of antibiotic exposure among the study population in the PCT implemented group. So my conclusion are, serial PCT measurement would allow a more judicious use of antibiotics, antibiotic stewardship. Serial PCT monitoring would be the first step against the global menace of antibiotic resistance. Reduced ICU cost is expected on de-escalation of antimicrobial therapy, and PCT-guided antibiotic therapy is safe and improves clinical outcome. These are my references, and thank you.
I think you are without a sound. Oh,
sorry. That was a good presentation. I'm sorry, I'm not with the sound. Okay. Dr. Sudhakar, do you have any question?
Yes, two questions.
Hello. Please go ahead.
First, I would like, procalcitonin is kind of validated to de-escalate antibiotics, but by any chance, do you use it to start antibiotics in critical unit or only to de-escalate in this protocol? And a second question is, what was the protocol? What is the level of procalcitonin that you use to de-escalate? I don't think Joy over here.
Joel, you are there?
Hello?
Joel, you are there? Yeah, you are audible.
Sir, what we have done is that with the implementation of PCT, we are empirically starting a patient on antibiotics. We have reduced the number of antibiotic duration in the patient. Like, we empirically started the patient on in some antibiotics, and we don't know when the bacterial infection has come down. This procalcitonin is a specific and sensitive marker and also has a high negative predictive value. So by looking at the value of the procalcitonin, we can decide that the bacterial infection has come down, and we can selectively de-escalate the particular antibiotics.
Okay.
Dr. Sudhakar?
Yeah, so what was your control group? So you told cohort, so it was not clear for me. What was your control group?
So both were sepsis patient. One was before implementation of PCT and other was post-implementation of PCT.
Okay, so it is a follow-up, right?
Yeah, it's more of like two groups.
Two groups. So two different patients who are given and who are not given.
Yes, sir. Not PCT measured in one group and PCT not measured in other groups, sir.
Okay, so PCT measured in group who are given antibiotics?
No, sir. Sir, this is a change in hospital policy. Like before the implementation of PCT, there was no hospital policy deciding that you should serially measure the PCT value for de-escalation of antibiotic. We just empirically start them on antibiotics, and just by clinically looking at them, or more of the CRP value, we decide that this patient has subsided, and we have to de-escalate the antibodies. So what this policy has done is that we are serially measuring the PCT value, which is a biomarker, and we, mm-hmm. we can judicially de-escalate the antibiotic, and we can prevent the number of ICU days, the duration of antibiotic exposure, and also we can increase the proportion of patients that can be de-escalated.
So what do you think in a research angle, so measuring a CRP level initially and then planning your study, because you don't have any starting point?
Sir, this research is actually four papers. One is the implementation thing, and the second one is comparing the proportion, the sensitivity and specificity between CRP, procalcitonin, and something called as interleukin 6. This is another mm-hmm. thing, and also there is other one in which we compare the barriers that can be associated with implementation of such thing. A clinician's point of view, what may be the barriers that can be there when we implement such a policy as a routine hospital policy?
Okay, good.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Arun Kumar?
There are no questions, thank you.
Okay, and from the audience, any questions do you have for this presentation? You can either unmute or you can put up in the chat box.
No questions, Kaushik, from the audience for this presentation.
Okay, so thank you, Joel, for the presentation. So I'll call the next participant, Lasya Kondapalli. Are you there?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. So you can unmute and you can switch on the video and you can share the screen. And she's presenting on the topic effectiveness of hydration in prevention of contrast-induced nephropathy among patients undergoing PCI or coronary angiography in a tertiary care center, and she's from Gandhi Medical College, Telangana.
Can you see the presentation?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. My topic for today is effectiveness of hydration in prevention of contrast-induced nephropathy among patients undergoing coronary angiography or percutaneous coronary intervention. The use of contrast media has increased tremendously, yet it has its own complication, one of which is contrast-induced nephropathy. It is the third most common cause of hospital-acquired kidney injury. It can be prevented. The complications are chronic kidney injury and end-stage renal disease, which might require lifelong dialysis. It is associated with mortality, prolonged hospital stay, and increased medical costs. Definition. It is acute exacerbation of renal dysfunction after contrast administration without other identifiable causes. It is measured by either elevation of serum creatinine by 0.5 mg per dL or an increase of more than 25% from the baseline serum creatinine value within 3 days. The causes. There are three main causes: oxidative stress, vasoconstriction, and direct tubular toxicity. So how to prevent CIN? Hydration. Hydration is the most simple, feasible, and effective preventive method. It enhances contrast elimination, prevent medullary hypoxemia, maintain renal perfusion, and enhance antioxidant mechanisms. My aims and objectives are to evaluate CIN in patients undergoing elective cardiac catheterization or PCI, efficacy of hydration treatment, to evaluate a simple risk score among the patients. Materials and methods. A cross-sectional study observation has been conducted from February 2019 to December 2019. This study design, prospective, non-interventional, type of study, observational open cohort, place of study, Department of Cardiology, Gandhi Hospital. My sample size was 360 patients. Inclusion criteria, all consecutive patients undergoing diagnostic cardiac catheterization. Patient exclusion criteria, with pre-existing renal disease with any allergy or history of contrast media administration within prior 7 days. Materials, information form, informed consent, pro forma for data collection, and SPSS version 20 was used. The 360 patients were divided into three groups of control, early hydration and late hydration each. Eligible patients were randomly assigned in 1:1:1 ratio. Patients assigned to early hydration were administered with 1 to 1.5 ml per kg per hour, 6 hours before and 2 hours after contrast administration, whereas in the late hydration group, 1 to 1.5 ml per kg per hour, 6 hours after the contrast administration, whereas in the control group, there was no hydrated. Approval was obtained from the Science and Ethics Committee before starting the project. This was the sample data comparison between the control, early hydration, and late hydration group. a simple Mehran risk score was calculated for each and every patient before performing the procedure. Factors like hypertension, IABP, age, anemia, diabetes were given the respective score. As the score increases, the risk of dialysis also increases. My results, the overall incidence of CIN was 20.6%. 74 out of 360 sample patients developed CIN, 34 in the control group, 24 in the late hydration, and 12 in the early hydration developed CIN. You can clearly see that only 12 people in the early hydration developed CIN. Observation and discussion, CIN incidence of 28.3% was estimated for the control group, while 16.5% was assumed for the adequate hydration group, which is a 58% relative reduction. This prospective randomized study shows patients with acute myocardial infarction treated with primary PCI, intravenous volume expansion is beneficial against CIN development. For hospitalized patients, volume expansion should begin 4 hours prior to the procedure and continued 6 to 12 hours post-procedure. A nephropathy risk score have to be calculated. My study limitations, serum creatinine to measure the renal function has its limitations. Different type of contrast media used in different patients may have caused some variation in the measurements. I conclude my study by saying that prevention is the cornerstone of CIN management and hydration therapy is the cornerstone of CIN prevention in an era in which primary PCI is the preferred reperfusion treatment for patients with STEMI, standard pharmacological treatment associated with early hydration protocol might reduce the chances of development of CIN. This was the references used. Thank you.
Nice presentation, Lasia. So let's move on to the question and answer session. We'll start with Dr. Arun Kumar. Do you have any questions?
Yes. Can you just go to the result section first slide? The one where you had compared the characteristics.
So this one, this is the results.
No, the first slide where you had three columns with mean age. Yes.
When it's too small, okay.
Fine. So my question is like, how did you really randomize these three people into three groups? Because one thing is like there are also ethical issues when you're randomizing. So what was the strategy used for randomizing? Yeah.
So it was actually based on the age or the presence of. It is actually based on the age, sir. Like for example, if it was before 60 years, like if there are what three patients in 1:1:1 ratio. If like it was between 65 to 70, if there were six patients in 2:2:2, it was divided like that, sir.
Okay, because from what I understand, the mean age, it's all similar and most of the characteristics are similar. But yes, how did you really make the choice of putting a patient in that early hydration or late hydration?
No, sir.
Because
it was
also involved ethical issues, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah. So that's what I'm trying to understand. Like, how did you really
make the decision? But for patients who have already a little worse serum creatinine level when compared to the others, were preferred to give early hydration when compared to the late hydration, who already had a little higher serum creatinine level.
Okay, Lasia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And next, Dr. Sudhakar.
Yeah, so my question is answered. So Dr. Arun has already asked the same question. So I was asking sir. About the division of the group. So it's answered.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Rodrigo?
Hello, Lasia. Congratulations for the presentation. It's been
thank
good.
You, sir.
A question. Do you control for the use of any acetylcysteine in the two groups? There was a paper 20 years ago about the use any acetylcysteine to prevent
yes, sir. N-acetylcysteine is used.
N-acetylcysteine use in these three groups?
No, sir. It was just hydration. It was just normal saline. There was no N-acetylcysteine.
No patients in any of the groups received?
No, sir. It was not given. There was no N-acetylcysteine given. It was just normal saline.
Okay. Thank you. Only that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And Is that the audience have any question regarding the presentation?
No, Kaushik, no questions from the audience.
Okay, fine, fine. And thank you, Lesia, for your presentation. So next, the next participant is Maria Luisa. On the topic, first, Maria Luisa, you're there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you can. I can hear you. So you can turn on your video as well as
can you see me?
Your presentation. Yeah.
Are we sure?
Yeah, you can share your presentation. And she is presenting on the topic, Brazil and the United States of America, a comparative look at cases and deaths per COVID-19. And she's from UNIFTC, Brazil. So you can go ahead with your presentation.
Hi, everyone. My name is Maria Luisa. I am a medical student from Brazil, and I am going to be talking about Brazil and the United States, a comparative look at cases and death per COVID-19. In the global scenario, 2020 has been marked by COVID-19 pandemic, which has become a public health emergency of international interest due to its clinical and epidemiological consequence. For this region, a major problem was installed: the disproportionate relationship between the number of clinical and ICU beds available and the expressive number of infected people, making it extremely difficult to control and treat the infection, and consequently increasing the number of deaths. In this context, Brazil and the United States stood out due to the high rates of infection expansion and the difficulty in population monitoring, which contributed to the rate of worrying levels of the disease. We aim to compare the number of cases and deaths of COVID-19 in Brazil and in the USA in the last 7 months. This is an epidemiological retrospective and descriptive study accomplished through the consultation of Brazilian's data by the coronavirus panel and America's data by the New York Times on COVID-19 during the period between March and September of 2020. So about 4.5 million of cases of COVID-19 were reported in Brazil, and 6.6 million cases of their disease were registered in the USA. In Brazil, 135,000 of them progressed to death, and in the USA, 196,000 progressed to death. So in Brazil, 3% of the cases progressed to death, and in the USA, 2.9% progressed to death. So in Brazil, about 631,000 cases and about 19,000 deaths occurred per month. And in the USA, about 949,000 cases and 28,000 deaths occurred per month. The growth curve of Brazilian cases remained gradual until August, with a subsequent decrease, and American cases, despite gradual growth, remains below 50,000 records until July and mid-August. Despite Brazil and the USA maintaining a similarity in their territorial dimensions, the USA had a high incidence and number of deaths for COVID-19. Faced with such epidemic scenario, more in-depth and detailed studies on the progression of the disease are essential in order to serve as a basis for assertive and solid public policy. The disparities is evidenced by the rapid spread of cases and mortality in the USA, to the detriment of Brazil, which leads us to questions whether this would be the result of the lack of a single public health system in the USA, which would serve all equally, in addition to the fact that the implementation of isolation measures was carried out later in the country. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Maria. Let's move on to the question session. Doctor, have any question? Dr. Sudhakar?
No.
Dr. Rodrigo?
More of a comment. I think that the comparison between Brazil and US is difficult because the disease happens in different moments. For instance, when you put numbers, the number of deaths in Brazil compared to US by million of people was higher in US. Now it's higher in Brazil. Brazil is probably the fifth more higher here. But it was an interesting study. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And Dr. Arun Kumar.
Yeah. Hi, Maria. I have one question for you.
Okay.
So what was your source of data?
Okay. Like I say, in Brazil, it was the coronavirus panel.
Okay.
Let me put coronavirus panel here.
Mm-hmm.
It's used for the government of Brazil.
Okay.
And in America, it was the New York Times.
Okay, so this was from the media and not from any scientific database, is it?
Yeah, but the results are comfortable.
Okay, so there is just one more thing. Is what do you think is the limitation of this study?
Well, there is just like I say, just an abstract. So we need to make more study to comprove that the pandemic was worse in the USA. We need to make more study to comprove.
Okay. So what is your final conclusion?
Like I say, the curve grow faster in the USA.
Mm-hmm.
It could be for, like I say, the lack of a single public health, like we have here in Brazil. We have the SUS, single public health, could be for this or not.
Okay, so what do you think is the implication in policies? Because in your conclusion, I can see that you've written as for solid public policies.
Yes,
so what
yes,
do you think
yes.
is an implement the implication of the of your findings in any public health policy?
I don't understand. Sorry. Can you repeat?
No. Your conclusion says that you need to have solid public policies, right?
Yeah.
So you have got a finding. So how do you think is your findings links to a policy? Because whatever you presented is something like it is more like a comparative statistics comparative statistics between during a time period where the catchment area. The resource of data has been different. So that itself is, there'll be a lot of bias in that. So what do you think is the implication in policy?
So
maybe, I'm asking,
okay, can
continue. Yeah. So I'm asking it from your conclusion slide.
Okay. I think it's a difference between the public health in USA and public health in Brazil. Like I say, in Brazil, we have this... like I say, SUS, system health, it could be this.
Okay. Now, my one question is why was the study done in the first place? Why did you really want to compare between United States and Brazil? Because when you are very clearly telling it's two different countries having two different timelines of pandemic.
I don't understand again, sorry.
Okay, no issues. Thank you. Thanks for presenting.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, Maria. And audience, do you have any questions?
No, Karthik, no questions from the audience.
Okay.
Thank you,
Maria. You can quit your screen. So the next participant, Maulidia Ekaputri, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. So the next, you can... share your screen. The next Maulidia Ekaputri, and she's presenting on the pre-diabetes status among the offsprings of type 2 diabetes mellitus patients, and she's from Universitas Indonesia.
Okay, good evening to all the judges. My name is Maulidia Ekaputri. I am from Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Indonesia. I'd like to present our research titled The Role of Paternal History of Type 2 Diabetes Mellitus on Pre-Diabetes Status Among the Offspring of Type 2 Diabetes Mellitus Patients. It has been widely known that diabetes mellitus is a major non-communicable disease accounting for many comorbidities and mortalities associated with its complication. Before developing diabetes, all patients actually gone through a phase called prediabetes, which consists of impaired glucose tolerance and impaired fasting glucose. The risk of developing prediabetes is higher in the offspring of type 2 diabetes patients. Hence, prevention in this population is especially really important. While the risk factors of diabetes in general population has been much studied, the factors among the offspring of population was much less. Hence, the study aimed to determine the factors associated with pre-diabetes status among the offspring of type 2 DM patients. In this study, 59 offspring of type 2 DM patients aged more than 8 years old were recruited consecutively. Then they were asked to fill a self-reported questionnaire to obtain the demographic data, lifestyle, and physical activities. Then physical exam was performed to obtain the blood pressure, anthropometric measurement, and waist circumference. On the same day, a blood sample is taken to obtain the HbA1c level. Four subjects were excluded because they had HbA1c level exceeding 6.5%, and the remaining 54 subjects were included in the statistical analysis. The demographic distribution of subjects, mainly aged more than 30 years old, dominated by female, and the majority of them received formal education until high school. 2/3 of them were housewives and mainly were in the middle-lower economic level. Of 54 subjects, 31.5% had HbA1c level between 5.7 and 6.4%, which is pre-diabetes, and the majority of them had maternal history of type 2 DM. Bivariate analysis was performed between all socio-demographic, clinical, and lifestyle parameters with pre-diabetes status, and the variables with p-value less than 0.25 were included in the logistic regression, which are education, parental history of type 2 DM, sedentary activity, smoking behavior, body mass index, and waist circumference. Using logistic regression analysis, it was found that paternal history of DM and waist circumference were significantly associated with prediabetes status. Smoking was also significantly associated, but the confidence interval didn't show a precise result. In contrast, sedentary behavior inversely related with prediabetes status. The proportion of prediabetes in this study is higher than the prevalence of impaired glucose tolerance in Indonesian population obtained from National Basic Health Research in 2007, which is 10%, and higher than the proportion of impaired glucose tolerance in the offspring of DM patients among Pima Indian adults, which is 22.2%. The relationship between paternal history of type 2 DM and prediabetes in this study was not supported by the majority of previous studies, which demonstrated that maternal history gave a stronger effect to the occurrence of glucose intolerance among the offspring. However, one study found that the offspring of fathers with early onset diabetes without diabetic mother had lower early insulin secretion compared to the offspring of mothers with early onset diabetes without diabetic father. The association between central obesity and prediabetes in this study is supported by previous studies and imply that central obesity may play important role in developing type 2 DM, especially in those at-risk population. The inverse relationship between sedentary behavior and prediabetes in this study is contradictory to the previous studies and more likely caused by the lack of smoker and the sedentary group of subjects, which were female in majority. We concluded that, one, the proportion of prediabetes status among the offspring of type 2 DM patients in this population was higher compared to the previous studies. And second, paternal history of type 2 DM and central obesity were associated with prediabetes status among the offspring of type 2 DM patients. That's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maldia. And I will go on to the question and answer session. And let me start with Dr. Rodrigo. Rodrigo, sir, do you have any question?
No, I don't have any questions. Thank you. Good presentation.
Thank you, sir. And Dr. Sudhakar?
Yeah, good presentation. So what is the status in other South Asian populations? Is there any study regarding the same, or what about the Western populations?
Okay, in my knowledge, until now, I didn't see any previous studies that studies the risk factors of developing prediabetes in among the offspring of type 2 DM. Most of them studied the risk factor of developing prediabetes in DM patients.
Okay, good.
Thank you, sir. And Dr. Arun Kumar?
Yeah, no questions. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And from the audience side, is there any question?
No questions. No okay. questions, Kaushi.
Okay. Thank you, Maldia. And you can quit your presentation. Okay. So the next participant, Nidhi Manoj, are you there?
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah. You can start
Thank
sharing
you.
Your screen.
Okay, I'll just share my screen.
And Nidhi Manoj is from Father Mulla Medical College, Karnataka, and she will be presenting on the topic usefulness of volume conductivity and scatter technology of Coulter LH750 in distinguishing malaria and dengue, two endemic vector-borne diseases.
Is my screen visible?
Yeah.
Okay, so good evening. My presentation is on the topic, the usefulness of volume, conductivity, and scatter technology of Coulter LH750 in distinguishing malaria and dengue to endemic vector-borne diseases. Malaria and dengue affect a large proportion of the world's population every year. Both are endemic to India. Malaria is caused by the protozoan of Plasmodium species, whereas dengue is due to dengue RNA arbovirus. The two are closely linked by the fact that both present with acute febrile illness, and both are mosquito-borne, albeit of different species. Malaria transmitted by the Anopheles and dengue by the Aedes aegypti mosquito. Early diagnosis is key to reducing morbidity and mortality. Research has looked into diagnosis using increasingly sophisticated yet commonly available hematological counters. Studies have put forth hematological parameters that alone or in combination have reliably identified infection. An example is the malaria factor, which has been proposed to reliably distinguish malaria. So the aim of the study was to use VCS parameters of leukocytes, including malaria factor, to distinguish between malaria positive and malaria negative, dengue positive and dengue negative, and malaria positive and dengue positive patients. So our study was set in the Department of Pathology of Father Mulla Medical College in India. It was a cross-sectional study, and data was collected for 2 months from 268 participants. Subjects who were malaria positive by light microscopy were selected, as well as subjects who were dengue positive by NS1 antigen test or MAC ELISA or IgG ELISA. Controls were those patients who were clinically suspected but tested negative for malaria and dengue respectively. Patients of either malaria or dengue who had any prior treatment with antibiotics were excluded. EDTA anticoagulated venous blood samples were analyzed by the Beckman Coulter LH750 hematology analyzers, which uses VCS technology to determine white cell characteristics, namely the size, relative nuclear and cytoplasmic ratio, and the nuclear lobularity and granularity. Following which, we calculated the malaria factor for each patient according to the formula. Malaria factor is equal to standard deviation of volume of lymphocytes to standard deviation volume of monocytes by 100. The data was analyzed by Levine's test for variance, independent t-test, and ROC analysis using SPS software version 20. Ethical clearance was obtained. Coming to the results, a total of 268 subjects were included in the study, where 72 were malaria positive, 46 were malaria negative controls, 105 were dengue positive, and 45 were dengue negative. In this table, I have highlighted in orange those parameters which showed a significant difference, that is the p-value of less than 0.05 in this case. Among these, all of the values were higher for malaria positive, except for scatter of monocytes. On ROC analysis, the malaria factor showed an area under curve of 0.9. At a cutoff of 3.5, we obtained a sensitivity of 94.7% and a specificity of 65.2%. Now, if a malaria factor was used in conjunction with those parameters showing a significant difference, as well as an area under curve greater than 0.7, these factors are highlighted here in red, the number of false positives decreases to 2 from 16. Now, in case of dengue positive versus dengue negative cases, all the parameters were higher in dengue cases except for the volume of eosinophils. Here, the malaria factor showed an AUC of 0.8. On ROC analysis, at a cutoff of 3.9, we obtained a sensitivity of 81.9% and a specificity of 77.8%. Again, if malaria factor was used in conjunction with parameters that showed a significant difference as well as an AUC above 0.7, there were found to be no false positives and the positive predictor value increased to 100%. Lastly, in case of malaria positive versus dengue positive patients, all the parameters were higher in dengue cases except for the volume of lymphocytes. Now here, although the parameters showed significant differences, they were not of adequate sensitivity and specificity to be of use for practical situations. Malaria factor was also not significantly different with a p-value of 0.728 and an AUC of 0.515. The higher volume parameters of lymphocytes and monocytes in malaria as compared to controls may be representative of a greater activation of these cells in comparison with other causes of febrile illness. Similar results were seen in dengue, and these can be expected due to its viral etiology. Malaria factor cannot possibly distinguish reliably between malaria and dengue. In conclusion, the findings suggest that VCS parameters and malaria factor can be utilized to calibrate automated analyzers to detect flags for easier and faster diagnosis of malaria and dengue from other febrile illness. Although the VCS parameters of leukocytes when examined between malaria and dengue revealed significant difference in some, there was no single parameter that had reliable sensitivity and specificity enough to be useful in practical situations to distinguish the two. We confer that calculated parameters such as malaria factor may not be useful in places endemic both for malaria and dengue. To overcome this limitation, further studies with larger number of participants and using multiple parameters may be needed to distinguish the two. These are my references. Thank you.
That's indeed a good presentation, Nidhi, and we'll move on to the question and answer session. Dr. Arun Kumar, do you have any questions?
Yeah, no questions. Thank you.
Dr. Rodrigo?
Good presentation. Interesting subject. I was wondering, the time of the disease influence the results? If you have 4 days of symptoms or 5 days of symptoms, or you don't study that on this particular study?
So actually the study that I did, only once the patients were clinically started showing symptoms of febrile illness, we started detecting it.
You don't have patients could have 1 day of fever and
no, so I don't have data of within how many days they showed to the hospital.
Then Dr. Sudhakar.
Yeah, so very simple question as a layman, I'll again ask you. So how do you think this method will be more useful because you have more reliable and quicker techniques to detect malaria in endemic regions as well as dengue? So how do you think this will be very useful compared to other methods available?
I feel it'll be more useful because already hematological analyzers are being used in hospitals to analyze the complete blood count and other such things. So if it was calibrated to give a flag in case the malaria factor was detected to be significant, we could help for earlier diagnosis and faster diagnosis. There is no need for extra equipment or expenditure on other equipment.
I mean, there are several febrile illness cases, I mean, causes for the febrile illness. So why have you selected only dengue and malaria? Because it could be any other.
So currently other studies, because early diagnosis in malaria and dengue can affect the morbidity and mortality in the long run. And other studies are being conducted currently for detection of other febrile illness using the same hematological analyzers.
So that's the point. So you would like, given a chance, you would like to add other febrile illness also, right? So it will be more comprehensive in deciding the exact, coming to yes, the exact sir. Cause, yeah? Right? Okay.
Thank you, sir. And from the audience side, is there any question?
No question, no.
Okay. Thank you, Nidhi. And
thank you.
You can quit your presentation. So okay. The next participant, Praveen Kumar RJ, SRM College of Pharmacy, Tamil Nadu. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Praveen Kumar?
Yeah, I'm here.
Switch on your video.
Yeah. Is my screen visible?
Yeah. And he's going to present on the topic, effect of Aubrey in overweight and obese adult population, a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial. And your slide is visible. You can start your presentation.
Yeah. A pleasant good evening, everyone. I'm here to present a topic on effect of Aubrey, which is an Ayurvedic proprietary medicine in overweight and obese adult population. It's a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial. I'm doing PharmD internship at SRM College of Pharmacy. And these are my guides. They have guided me and they have immensely helped me to conduct the trial. And I've given my abstract. I've divided it into purpose, methods, parameters, results, and conclusions, as well as the keywords. And moving on to the introduction, obesity is a global problem, which is leading to various illnesses such as type 2 diabetes mellitus, cardiovascular diseases, and osteoarthritis, and various other diseases. I've just mentioned some. And there are many agents which were to treat obesity, and I've listed the drugs and their classes, and those drugs were withdrawn from the market due to their safety and other concerns. And because of all these issues, the current research has been shifted towards the herbal supplements. And in herbal supplements, I have chosen Ayurveda, which is an ancient science of life, and it has been practiced in India since the 12th century BC. It is a combination of physical, mental, and social spiritual well-being. And there is an ancient book called Charaka Samhita, which is in Sanskrit word, which says clearly about the Ayurveda. In Ayurveda, we have three things, which is Vadam, Pittam, and Kapham. And we say it is Vada, Pitta, and Kapha. And when there is a problem arises in these three constituents, there comes a problem. And this leads to indigestion, disturbed metabolism. Because of this, weight problems can occur. And whenever the Kapha constituent gets increased, the fat metabolism gets hampered and the person becomes obese. And I've done the literature review and I've given author, journal, year and outcomes starting from the year of 2019 to 1995, and this is my review of literature and need of the study. And there were no head-to-head randomized control trial. This is my first trial, which is checking the effectiveness of Aubrey, which is an Ayurvedic drug. And I've given the aims of my study. The aim of the present study is to determine the effect of Aubrey capsule on the serum lipid profiles, plasma adiponectin levels, body fat, skin fold thickness, and anthropometric measurements in overweight and obese individuals. I've given my objectives. And moving on to my methodology, the study design is in 6-month randomized double-blind placebo-controlled clinical trial. And the study site is Ayurveda Outpatient Department, which is Metabolic Ward, in the IISM. IISM means Interdisciplinary Indian System, Institute of Indian System of Medicine. And I've practiced ICH-GCP E6 guideline as well as the revised version of Declaration of Helsinki. And informed consent was obtained from the patients, and institutional ethical committee approval was obtained, and this is the grant number. And the clinical trial registry of India was registered, and this is my reference number. And moving on to the inclusion and exclusion criteria, and the subjects of overweight greater than 25 and obese patients of BMI greater than 30 were included in the study, and subjects of either gender and age group between 18 to 50 years were included. And my exclusion criteria included special population and patients who are on other anti-obesity medications and who are not willing to give informed consent, and these were my exclusion criteria. And my interventions, I've used placebo 500 mg and Aubrey 500 mg. We'll see what Aubrey in the next slides. The appearance of the Aubrey and placebo capsules were made identical, and the package was also indistinguishable. And this is the investigational drugs. Each Aubrey capsule of 500 mg contains tribulus terrestris, which we call it as in common name it is puncture vein, tribulus terrestris, and dolichos bifluorus, which we call it as horse gram, in vernacular it is called kollu, and Vitania somnifera, which is called as ashwagandha, it's in common name, 50 mg, and Carcinia gambogia, which is in Malabar tamarind, 300 mg, and Terminalia cebula, it is called as myrobalan, 50 mg. All these five constituents together constitute a single Aubrey capsule, and a placebo 500 mg. This is my investigational drug. And you could see I've just mentioned that in the table for easy understanding, the drugs and the constituents. In total, it comes around 500 mg. And the subjects were advised to take one capsule of Aubrey or placebo twice a day after the breakfast and the dinner. And my allocation concealment, I have performed third-party randomization, and computer-generated randomization list was also prepared. And sample size, it's in pilot study, and anticipating a dropout rate of 10%. Normal overweight obese was calculated and divided. And I've used waist circumference and using the body fat analyzer, I've checked for total body weight, visceral fat, subcutaneous fat, and skeletal muscle fat. And the skin fold thickness was measured using skin fold caliper. And this body fat analysis is Ombron Carada scan, which is a body fat analyzer. And I've calculated visceral visceral adiposity index using the formula for the male and the female. And estimation of the plasma adiponectin. Adiponectin is a golden biomarker, which is a standard biomarker for obesity. And 4 ml blood samples were obtained. And from this 4 ml, 2 ml was transferred to EDTA vacutainer. And the centrifugation was done and plasma was separated. And the remaining 2 ml samples was collected in Eppendorf's tubes.
I mean,
and,
you've crossed 5 minutes right now.
I'm sorry. And
we have to stop presenting.
Oh. Should I stop? Hello?
Yes, please take down your presentation.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry, actually.
No issues.
Can you actually put down your one second. Praveen Kumar, can you please put down your conclusion slide and then we'll go on with the questions.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sorry, just a minute. Yeah, and my conclusion is that after obtaining all these things, the supplementation with Opre, we have found statistical significant reductions in BMI, waist circumference, body fat, visceral fat, and all the lipid profile parameters. And plasma adiponectin levels were significantly higher in the Opre group than in the placebo. And these things, we had a lack of significant adverse events. There were only minor events such as abdominal pain. We didn't find anything in the 6-month trial, 24-week studies. And I hope this preliminary pilot study will help in the conducting of large-scale trials. And yeah, this is my conclusion, sir.
Thank you, Praveen. Dr. Arun Kumar, sir?
Yes. So
do you have any questions?
Yeah, I do have. Yes, Praveen, like this was your phase 1 trial, is it?
No, sir. It's in phase 4 trial, but I have can't. It's an Ayurvedic traditional herbs drug, sir. There were no previous studies conducted in this. It's already in the market, but there were no evidence.
Okay, so there was no evidence.
Yes,
okay,
sir, there was
in
no
that
evidence.
Case, if it's going to be yes. So another thing, if it's going to be phase 4. Then your sample size is very small.
Yes, sir.
26 is not.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I understand, sir. The thing is, like I said, it's just phase 4 because it's already in the market. It's already existing, sir. So that's why I said it is phase 4. But I know phase 4, we have a large sample size and all those things. I understand, sir. Thank you.
Okay. And then, like, what was your placebo?
A placebo was made identical to the.
No, that I understand. Like, what was it actually? What was the constituent of the placebo?
Excipients, sir.
Okay.
There were just normal excipients, like similarly made up of inactive ingredients, sir. There were no anything specially, sir.
Okay. Okay, fine, Praveen. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Sudhakar, sir.
Yeah, Praveen, interesting study. But I think, as you said, the sample size is too small.
Yes, sir.
And did you, within that 35 plus, or I think it is 30 plus samples. Okay.
So, yes, sir. 35 in each group, sir.
So, did you classify them based on Ayurvedic constitution before giving the trial?
No, sir. I've done third-party randomization. And
okay, it's a random.
After that, I've done allocation concealment using a SNOS procedure. And after that, we have divided into two groups, 35-35. And we have done the study, sir. And this is my random allocation chart.
Yes. Oh, this is what I'm asking.
Okay. This is me random. From 96, I've divided into 72, 36, 36. And finally, I've analyzed into 29 and 28 patients. Final analysis.
Good, good.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Rodrigo, your questions?
Yes, I think you have a problem with the presentation that I didn't see all them in a moment. It was like the screen. How much weight lost? It was lost. I didn't get the presentation.
Okay, sir. I'll just tell it in a brief. This is a correlation chart between the total body weight and plasma adiponectin level. In the placebo group, there was no correlation. But in the Opiray group, that is my test drug, there was a negative correlation. There was a significant reduction. And coming to the body weight and reduction, yes, sir, here it is. From initially, it was around 30 in the baseline. And in the first follow-up, that is in the 90th day, it was 29. And in the second follow-up of 180 days, it was 26.68, sir. This is the BMI value, sir. Plus or minus standard deviation, mean plus or minus standard deviation. From 30, it has reduced to 26.68, sir.
We're still following the patients to see if they will regain the weight after the conclusion of the study, or you stop falling? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay. And I'm sorry for the time consumption because my topic was a little elaborate. I'm really sorry for that.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Can I stop?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Does there any audience question? Is there any audience question?
Yeah, there was an audience question asking me that is this Obire is available in across the Ayurvedic stores in India? Is it available or is it not?
It is very limited, actually. It is very limited and very it's available in very particular places, actually, to say. It's not available widely across the country or in either foreign places. That's okay. The reason to generate the evidence. We have conducted this pilot trial. Okay. Still, we should conduct a large population trial. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Praveen. And let's call upon the next participant, Rodrigo Dominic from Mexico. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, you can turn on your video and you can share your PPT. So Rodrigo Dominic is going to present on the topic association between the atrial myxoma and mitral regurgitation. And he's from the Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México. So you can start your presentation. I think you should shift your tab. Hello? You're there?
Hello? Okay. Yes, association. I'm Rodrigo Dominic Sergarac from Mexico, and I will present my protocol association between atrial myxoma and mitral regurgitation. Introduction: primary tumors represent a low frequency pathology with a highly varied clinical spectrum from asymptomatic patients in which is diagnosis as a causal finding while still in another pathology to those who have suffered embolic processes. Mitral regurgitation is known as the lack of coaptation of the leaflet found in the mitral valve, which allows blood from the left ventricle to go back to the same side atrium during the diastole. Objective. The objective of this study is to find the association between the atrial myxoma and mitral regurgitation to implement the holistic surgical approach for patients suffering from this pathology. Methodology. A prospective cohort was performed for 12 months. The initial sample consists of 26 60-year-old old men who were diagnosed with atrial myxoma without alterations on their mitral valves. They were sorted in two groups according to their clinical manifestations. Two groups were compared in which the development of mitral regurgitation. In group one, with six patients, those with no symptoms were selected. And in group two, with 20 patients, those with symptoms were be selected. The whole study was performed from March 2020 to March 2019 to March 2020. And a bi-monthly evaluation was done where the patients were studied with an echocardiogram and electrocardiogram, this to evaluate possible complications. This allowed us to assess road as well as the possible effects in this respect. The chi-square distribution was used to evaluate the statistical significance. Results. What of all the patients from group one, none of them present mitral regurgitation. Out of all of the patients in group two, 13 of them, 65%, presented mitral regurgitation. Conclusion, the risk of developing atrial myxoma from secondary mitral regurgitation when presenting symptoms is 2.4 times higher than compared to when the patient does not present symptoms. This gives place to a line of research for complementing the evaluation of atrial myxoma with the above evaluation. The bibliography. And thanks.
So that was a good presentation, and we'll start with the question and session. So let's start with Arun Kumar, sir.
There are no questions. It's a pretty straightforward presentation. Thanks.
Then Rodrigo, sir.
Oh, hello. Only one question. Do you control the regurgitation for other factors like the patient had hypertension or other disease that could affect also the heart?
Yes, we select the patients who was previously held, and the diagnosis with an echocardiogram in the patients without symptoms was an insidious diagnosis.
Okay.
Then Dr. Sudhakar, sir.
Yeah, no questions. You can go ahead.
Okay, any audience questions? Any audience question? Okay. So thank you, Rodrigo. You can quit your presentation, and we'll call upon the next participant. Is that Samad Goyal from Kasturba Medical College, Manipal, is there?
Yes, I'm there.
Okay, you can turn on your video. And other participants, I request you to just unmute yourself. And he's going to present on the topic, clinic variables responsible for early and late diagnosis of foreign body aspiration in pediatrics age group. You can start your presentation. Your slide is visible.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay, I am starting. Good evening, everyone. This is Samar Goyal. I am a final year MBBS student from Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. The topic of my research is clinical variables responsible for early and late diagnosis of foreign body aspiration in pediatrics age group. Foreign body aspiration, as we all know, is a serious medical emergency which occurs both in children as well as adults. But in children, it is much more common because they tend to swallow everything which comes into their hand. It is a primary cause of accidental death in age group of 12 months to 3 years of age. Foreign body in the airway can lead to choking and ultimately death if the diagnosis is delayed. Coming on to the most important point in this slide is National Safety Council of America in 2016 proposed the rate of fatal choking in children less than 5 years of age to be 0.43 per 1 lakh, which led us to aim to analyze retrospectively and determine the predictors like history of presentation, physical and radiological findings, which help in early diagnosis of foreign body aspiration. We also intend to study the parameters which led us to delayed diagnosis. A retrospective analysis was done by analyzing 37 recalls who came to Kasturba Hospital between January 2014 and December 2018 after obtaining an institutional ethical clearance. Final results and complications were documented, and we have summarized them as percentage and proportions. As you can see in this given table one, 86.4% of the patients belong to age group less than 3 years, and only 13% of them were greater than 3 years of age. This is probably because children less than 3 years of age, they have an immature cuff reflex. In the second table, as you can see, around 55% of patients, they came after 1 week of ingestion of foreign body, whereas only 45% came before 1 week. In this figure, as you can see, people whose duration of stay in a hospital was less than 5 days. As you can see in this less than 5 days, only 28.5% had received a local treatment somewhere else. Whereas whose duration of stay was more than 5 days, around 51% had received an treatment elsewhere. This strongly and clearly suggests that children who were treated symptomatically took more time to recover. Most common presenting features in people who presented in less than 1 week were increased respiratory rate and effort, wheezing and wet cough, whereas who presented late, that is greater than 1 week, came with chief complaints of fever and dry cough. History of foreign body aspiration was present only in 47% of early cases and 20% of late cases. 81% of our cases had ingested an organic or vegetative foreign body such as peanut, vegetable or areca nut, whereas metallic or pin were ingested by a very little 2%. This slide suggests the physical examination and the radiological findings. In our study, more foreign body was ingested and found to be in the left bronchus as compared to the right bronchus. The common respiratory physical findings were decreased chest movements or air entry on the ipsilateral sides, bronchi and crepitus. And the radiological findings which were common were lung collapse and the mediastinal shift. All the cases, coming on to the treatment part, all the cases underwent rigid bronchoscopy. Only in 4 of the cases, we had to do flexible bronchoscopy due to incomplete removal, slippage of some part into segmental bronchus. Coming on to the discussion, children, especially less than 3 years of age, are very susceptible to foreign body aspiration complications, as I told, because of immature defense mechanisms. Often, the presentation and initial diagnosis are vague, which impedes the early diagnosis. It was found that delay in presentation was because of many reasons, including unintentional aspiration by child unnoticed by parents, lack of respiratory symptoms, vague clinical history, and unwillingness by the treating physician to go for a chest X-ray. It was noted that the duration of treatment at the local hospital was directly proportional to the duration of admission later for effective management, which is a very important finding in my study. In our study, normal chest X-ray was found only in 39% of the patient. That is because, as I already said, 81% of patients had organic foreign body ingestion, which is very difficult to make out initially in the chest X-ray. But later, when the organic substance swells with inflammation, it occludes the bronchus completely and typical chest X-ray finding occurs. This is in complete contrast to most of the metallic objects, which are radiolucent and they can be easily picked up on a chest X-ray. It was found out that if there was a complete obstruction, these patients were referred early. Delay usually occurred in patients with incomplete obstruction with a normal chest X-ray. A lack of history of inhalation most commonly led to delayed presentation and resulted in various respiratory complications like pneumothorax and atelectasis. This is my presentation in just one slide. People who presented early to us, we took a thorough history clinical examination and chest X-ray. If we suspected a foreign body, a rigid bronchoscopy as soon as possible was done. If the foreign body was found, it was retrieved and successfully removed. If the retrieval was incomplete, we had to go for a flexible bronchoscopy. If no foreign body was found, we had to do a bronchoalveolar lavage and it was treated. If the patient presented with delayed presentation because of treatment at a local physician with IV antibiotics and bronchodilators and no improvement was done, he was further referred to the tertiary center like us, and the same procedure of rigid bronchoscopy was done. If complications were found, we treated the complication. Conclusion: early diagnosis and referral reduces complication mortality. Initial chest X-ray is a must, and in a current situation, we should never be indecisive doing a rigid bronchoscopy. These are my references. And I would really like to thank Medical Records Department at KH for providing access to case reports. Also, I would like to thank my guide, that is Guru Prasad Rai, who really helped me out with this. Thank you, judges and audience.
Thank you, Samad Goyal. And we'll start with the question and answer session. To begin with, Dr. Rodrigo, do you have any questions?
How was the rate of complications? Because I find in the presentation the factors associate the symptoms, but not the complications.
So there were few complications such as atelectasis and obstructive diseases and collapse. And they were mostly found in people who presented late. And out of the late presentation, most of them had been referred from a local physician to us.
Okay. Thank you.
Then Dr. Sudhakar.
Yeah, it's a nice presentation. So it's clear, no questions.
Dr.
Yeah, no questions from my, no questions from my side as well. Thank you.
Okay. Any questions from the audience side?
There are no questions.
Okay. Thank you, Samad Goyal. You can quit your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
So the next participant is Sanjay Bethan Botla from Osmania Medical College, Hyderabad. Are you there?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Okay. Yes, so you can start sharing the screen. So he's going to present the topic validation and verification of body fluids for chemistry parameters on automated integrated system. So the slides are visible. You can start your presentation.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. And, I'm Sanjay from Usmania Medical College. I'm pursuing my first year. And my topic is on validation and verification of body fluids for chemistry parameters on automated integrated system. Introduction. Majority of automated instruments are validated and verified for serum and urine chemistry parameters. Just a second. Yeah. However, manufacturers do not provide performance verification for body fluids. Since body fluids such as acetic, pleural, CSF, dialysate, and pericardial fluid specimens form a part of testing panel for a variety of analytes. The accreditation bodies that certify and accredit labs follows ISO 15189-2012. That states validation should be carried out when there is a deviation from stated procedure. In healthcare, then the analysis of body fluids plays an important role in the diagnosis and management of a wide variety of conditions. Aim, and here comes aim and objective. The aim of the study is to establish performance characteristics for commonly requested analytes in body fluids. And here's materials and methods. Leftover samples were utilized for validation or verifications of 10 common analytes specific to each of the above mentioned body fluids on Abbott Architect CI8200 integrated system. Performance characteristics that were verified are as follows: impression, accuracy, reportable range, stability, and interference. And here are the two picks you can go through. Approach to body fluid chemistry. The strategies described are meant to serve a guide and should not replace a laboratory-specific accrediting agency regulation. It is responsible to the laboratory director to determine the extent of validation or verification required. And here's a point noted. What does analyte mean? A analyte is a substance whose chemical constituents are being identified and measured. So some commonly encountered fluid types and corresponding analytes are given. So some commonly encountered fluid types are like venous fluid, CSF fluid, peritoneal, pericardial, and pleural fluid. And these are the analytes to each. And the result, assay impression for the body fluids, assays were comparable to impression obtained from serum. Accuracy was evaluated with recovery experiment after spiking the sample with a known concentration of substance. Reportable range was found to be comparable to serum parameters. Chemistry analytes for a body fluid analytes were found to be stable for a period of 20 days at minus 20 degrees Celsius. Conclusion, it is a mandatory for lab to establish validation and verification of the body fluid assays for commonly requested analytes. These would improve the reliability of the testing system. And here are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjay. And let's move on to the question session. Let's start with Dr. Sudhakar. Do you have any questions, sir?
I don't have any from my side.
Dr. Arun Kumar?
Yeah, I have a few questions. Sanjay, yours is a verification and validation study, right?
Yes, sir.
So verification and validation studies are usually pitched against a gold standard, which you call as a predicate device that is already existing in the market. But whatever, yes, the Abbott Architect is an already verified and validated device, right?
Yes, sir.
So now you're doing that for your body fluids. That I understand.
Yes, sir. Yes, exactly.
But this should be compared with the gold standard. Against which gold standard did you really compare?
When compared, I think
because you understand my question, right? So it has to be calibrated, and there's a benchmark, right?
Yes, sir.
So it has to meet a benchmark. See, whatever you have published results is from your own study. That how will you really verify and validate your findings?
Sure, sir.
So yes, it's not mentioned, right? Is it like you didn't mention or you didn't do at all?
Yeah, I have not mentioned.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Then what was the reliability?
Yeah, sorry, sir.
What was the reliability? Reliability score, because any validation verification study should have a reliability score.
Yeah, I haven't gone through it actually.
No, how is it? How is the? How will I really trust? How reliable is the method that you are actually proposing? So, what is your conclusion?
Your conclusion: it is mandatory. It's just mandatory for lab to establish validation verification model for fluid assays commonly requested analytes, which just improve the reliability for testing system.
How is that? Like, so see, this is like your topic is your conclusion that can't be there, right? So yes, there was an aim. What is actually your aim? That's what I'm trying to understand in from your research design.
The conclusion is like body fluid testing provides important information for clinical yes. diagnosis of a variety.
But that's not. But that's not your aim, right? Your aim is more on the verification and validation part.
Yes, sir.
But whereas you have concluded as if it's mandatory, because it's mandatory, that is like already established, and Abbott Architect is a gold standard. It's a benchmark in the market.
Yes, sure.
So you cannot do a benchmark study for the existing benchmark.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Yep. Otherwise, fine, Sanjay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you,
sir. Then Dr. Rodrigo.
Oh, no additional comments.
Okay. Thank you, sir, and thank you, Sanjay. And is there any audience question?
Yeah, no questions.
Okay. So then thank you, Sanjay, and you can quit your presentation. So we'll call upon the next participant. Is that Santanu J. Nair from Government yes, Medical College, Trivandrum there?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah. So you can start sharing your PPT. So he's going to present on the topic, profile and analysis of acute poisoning cases, a perspective from a tertiary care center in South India, along with the global comparison and solutions. And you can start your presentation now. It's visible.
Audible, right. Can I start?
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Good evening. My name is Shantanu. I'm a pre-final year MBBS student from Government Medical College, Trivandrum. I'm here to present my study entitled Profile and Analysis of Acute Poisoning Cases, a Perspective from a Tertiary Care Center in South India. As you already know, poisoning is a major problem for a long time and still continues to be so. But the patterns have changed. Patterns of poisoning have changed and are distinct in different parts of the world. If you look more closely, you'll see that the poisoning patterns have kept pace with the advancements in pharmacological and agricultural sciences. In developed countries of the West, pharmaceutical drugs were found to be the most commonly used poisonous agents. In contrast, studies from developing countries in Asia and Africa suggest, which have a largely agrarian economy, suggest that pesticides like organophosphates, etc., were the most commonly used poisons. A similar trend was observed in many studies across India, but the type of pesticide used varied between regions within the country itself. Thus, it becomes very clear that the regional variations and the socio-demographic factors play a vital role in determining the pattern of poison. Still, much work has not been done to find and explore more on this aspect in Kerala. And this being a problem because Kerala is a region which is much different from its neighboring and other states because of its different developmental characteristics. In fact, it is the country's leader in various social and developmental metrics. It also recently happened to have the highest suicide rate in the country. So we decided to explore the same in the unique South Indian state of Kerala in light of the current knowledge. So we did a prospective study on 100 consecutive cases, acute poisoning cases that presented to the non-pediatric casualty of GMC, Government Medical College Trivandrum, over the months of September and October of 2019. The required data from them was collected using a structured interviewer-administered questionnaire. The sample size was calculated based on this formula. And what we found was that the most cases were of pharmaceutical drug poisoning. It amounted to 48% of all cases, followed by rat poison, insecticide, etc. Actually, as I said before, such a pattern is usually seen only in developed nations and not so in other states of India and also studies from other low-income nations. We think that this trend similar to the developed countries may be a reflection of the de-agrarianization that comes along with development. And like, as you can see, polymedication was the single most category which was there. It amounted to 27.5%. And the single most used drug was found to be paracetamol, or also known as acetaminophen in different parts of the world. And even in polymedication, paracetamol was the most recurrently used drug. And as expected, most cases, 86% of the cases were due to suicides. And familial conflicts was found to be the most common reason for it. And in 17 cases, there was a previous poison exposure when we took their history. And of these, 58.8% of these were exposed to the same poisoning agent or the same combination of poisons. So restricting access to that particular agent may be wise to prevent such a future episode. So when we analyzed the various subgroups of this sample, we found some things which are interesting. For example, we found that males were more likely to be exposed to a pesticide in the form of rat poison or an insecticide, whereas a female would be more likely to be exposed to a drug or a corrosive. And similarly, as a person gets more educated, we found that the likelihood of him or her taking a drug would increase, and at the same time, his or her likelihood of taking a pesticide for poisoning would decrease. And also, if we assess the socioeconomic status, we found that a person below the poverty line is more likely to take a pesticide as a poison, whereas a person above the poverty line is more likely to take a drug as a poison. And when we looked at the comorbidities, we found that all patients with a history of diagnosed psychiatric disorder took a pharmaceutical drug as a poisonous agent, and 70% of them has attempted suicide before using some drugs. And similar observations were also made in few other studies across the globe, and few studies even concluded that a previous suicide attempt is the best predictor for a repeat attempt. So a proper psychiatric assessment and a follow-up of DSH, that is the suicide patients, especially those with diagnosed psychiatric disorders, is required to prevent future episodes. And it was also seen that in 75% of cases where antipsychotics were used for poisoning, it was seen that they had a previous exposure with the same poison. So we could suggest that access to drugs in general and their own antipsychotics in particular may be restricted for these psychiatric patients. So to conclude, these are the points I wanted
to... 5 minutes are up. Your 5 minutes are done.
These are my references. These are my guides. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Shan. Thank you, Shantanu. And we'll go for the question and answer session. So to start with, let's start with Dr. Sudhakar, sir.
Hello. Interesting presentation, Shantanu. But your study group is typically, I think it is basically from Trivandrum, which is a developed city. Vastness in the selection of the individuals, because if you go to interiors or village areas, or in most probably in the rural areas, people tend to take more of pesticides, and because they're more available there. And I think if you have taken only studied cases only from the cities, which without including rural areas.
No, sir. Actually, Trivandrum has rural regions also.
So when you're talking... I'm talking about your study group. So is it focused in one city, or is it from, does it have an equal distribution from all the different parts, like
a city, town, and an underdeveloped village?
Yes. Actually, the entire we conducted the study in the largest tertiary care center in Trivandrum. That is the Government Medical College, Trivandrum. And there are legal complications for this. So even if a person presents to a smaller hospital, they eventually have to be at least referred to our hospital. So I did not put this in the slides, but there are actually more than 50% of the patients were from rural areas.
So it is surprising to see pharmaceutical drugs as one of the choice because, in India, I agree, non-prescription medicines are easily available. But how come that in Western population? So availability of non-prescription medicine.
Sir, that when I said pharmaceutical drugs, it included both prescription and non-prescription drugs. There are mainly just of prescription drugs. And I did not conclude actually this. What is it?
No, my point is when you talk about paracetamol, so a patient will be given, you mean to say they will take overdose like 6 grams per day, which is very lethal?
Overdose? Okay. I did not get your question. I did not get the point.
See, acetamine is a OTC, right? So over-the-counter drug. Sir. So what you mean to say is they take excess dose to commit suicide, they take excess dose of paracetamol, right? Because it will, I think if you take at least even 2 mg, I don't think it will cause immediate hepatotoxicity. So
actually, there are cases where people took more than 50 tablets also.
Okay, let me sum up because we are running out of time. So my point is because availability of psychotic drugs is much lesser compared to other OTCs. So that could be one reason what I feel is.
You're right, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Rodrigo?
No questions from my side. No questions.
Dr. Arun Kumar?
Yeah, no questions from my side.
Okay, then. Thank you. Thank you, Shantanu, and we'll move on to the next presenter. Soumishri Nagendra.
Hello.
Are you there?
Am I visible?
From Bangalore Medical College and Research Institute, Karnataka. Yeah, you're audible.
And am I audible? Yeah.
One second. You're presenting on the topic, microbiological analysis of post-pulmonary tuberculosis infections.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for the introduction and warm greetings to everyone. So today I'll be presenting my research topic titled as Microbiological Analysis of Post-Pulmonary Tuberculosis Infections. Before getting into the study, I would like to address the question as to why post-tuberculosis. India stands number one in terms of prevalence of TB in high-risk burden countries worldwide, and it is estimated that 40% of Indian population is infected with TB bacteria. But the cure rate has seen an increase from 47% in 1999 to a whooping high of 95% in 2018. But then again, why again a study on post-tuberculosis? Let me give you an example and hence the introduction to the study. Let us say a person was diagnosed with TB. He was cured successfully and was cultured and sputum negative at the end. Do you think he will live a quality of life same as a healthy individual throughout his life? No, of course not, because pulmonary tuberculosis survivors experience lung function impairment, which can influence their quality of life. Morbidity really takes a toll on their life. Bacterial infections are one of the most important complications in post-TB patients, and extensive use of antibiotics has now even caused an increase in fungal infections. But this has been described only in selected populations. And hence, with this background, the current study was undertaken with the objective to identify common bacteriological and fungal agents causing post-pulmonary tuberculosis sequelae and also to know the antibiotic susceptibility profile. This was a prospective cross-sectional study with a sample size of 50 and was taken up in a tertiary hospital located in a densely populated area in Bengaluru, Karnataka. Both IPD and OPD patients were taken up and sputum was collected from them. These samples were then subjected to Gram stain and Zeal-Nielsen staining. Bacteriological analysis was done on meconkey and chocolate agar. Mycological analysis was done on severodextrose agar. Later on, the isolates were put on semi-automated analyzer VITEC-2 for speciation and antibiotic susceptibility. Fungal isolates were put on Chromaguard and LPCB mount. Coming to the observation and results. Highest frequency of cases was in the elderly age group of 60 to 70 years of age. Female preponderance was seen with a ratio of 3:2 as female to male. There were some coordination also seen with HIV and HBsAg. 32% of the cases had sequelae within 5 years of successful treatment. Bacteriological analysis. So 24% of the total samples yielded normal commensal growth. The most common organism isolated was Klebsiella pneumoniae, which accounted to 29%, followed by Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which accounted to 22%. Other organisms were Escherichia coli, Cetrobacter fruindii, and Enterobacter aerogenes. Mycological analysis yielded growth on 3 samples, in which 2 were identified as Candida parapsilosis and 1 was Aspergillus flavus. These are some of the pictures taken during the study and were isolated. These are also the isolates on Meconchian chocolate agar. Antibiotic susceptibility testing yielded highest resistance to ampicillin, followed by second generation cephalosporins, which were ceftazidime and cefotaxime. The most susceptible was gentamicin and amikacin, which were both aminoglycosides, and also colistin for Pseudomonas. Coming to the discussion and conclusions. The incidence of infective cause of post-TB sequelae from our study was 74%. The most prevalent organism was Klebsiella pneumoniae, followed by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This is in contrast to previous studies because Pseudomonas was by far the most common in previous studies. The most common fungal isolate was Candida parapsilosis, which shows a shift from Candida albicans. Highest resistance was seen towards ampicillin and cephalosporin. This drug resistance has been increased, and it also shows how rampant use of antibiotics is there in our generation today. The most active antimicrobials were gentamicin, amikacin, and colistin. From our study, we conclude that aminoglycosides, amikacin, and gentamicin can be effectively used as the drug of choice for empirical and also curative therapy. Take-home message or an implication is that this study is likely to help in rapid and effective management of post-tuberculosis infections in suspected cases. Sensitization of the patient with symptoms of post-TB infections for an earlier visit to healthcare facilities can reduce the impact of these infections. Because we all know acute life-threatening complication is TB-related sepsis. Hence, what we need to understand is that a microbiological cure is just a beginning to the treatment and, of course, not the end of the treatment of tuberculosis. I would like to extend my thanks to Dr. Harsha T.R. and Dr. Basavaraju to you for guiding me throughout the study. At last, not to forget, stay home and stay safe, and thank you for your time. Thank you.
Very nice presentation, and Soumishri, and we'll go for the question and answer round. So let me first ask Dr. Rodrigo. Any questions, sir?
Just understand, the study sample, are patients who present to emergency department with symptoms of respiratory infections or was ambulatory patients?
No, sir. The patients were actually from respiratory medicine department who came to the OPD or IPD section who had respiratory symptoms and they had a history of TB in the record. So they were suspected cases. Hence, we also had normal commensal growth in some of the cases.
Every one of them have pneumonia or could be upper respiratory infections?
Just an upper respiratory infection, sir. They have symptoms of upper respiratory infections, not only pneumonia.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Arun Kumar, sir?
Yeah, no questions. Thank you.
Dr. Sudhakar, sir?
Yeah, it's a very clean presentation. So, but I think the people in whom you found the post-tuberculosis infections, and you correlate, you say that it is a post-TB sequel, whatever infection is there. So what is, I think the age is above 60, if I'm correct what you have presented.
No, sir. Actually, the inclusion criteria, exclusion was only for age, as 12 years, above 12 years, any case we took. We have cases from 35 years, and the oldest patient was around, I think he was 74 years old. But so the most cases were from 60 to 70 years old.
So what you found infections, the whatever observation you have seen, that is in 62 plus years, right?
No, sir. About 35 years, all cases, like
we had cases.
No, I'm talking about the positive cases with post tuberculosis infections. No, sir.
We had from all age groups. The most cases which we saw that, I'll just go to that one second. Most prevalent was highest frequency was from 60 to 70. That accounted for 34% of the total cases, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I understood your question. Okay. You said, I think it was there in all cases. In all age groups, we had cases. Most frequent one was from 60 to 70 years of age.
So if I say that, because as you told, the Pseudomonas infection is quite common after tuberculosis because of the compromised immunity or whatever. So if I argue that the infection is random and it's not correlated or linked to post tuberculosis infection, so how do you support that?
Sir, I think it can also be possible. For that, I think the sample size is a great limiting factor here. So we should do the study in higher populations so that we can find out whether that correlation is really true or not.
Yeah, okay, good.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. And any audience question to be asked for this presentation?
Yeah, no questions.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Sir Mishri. So the next presenter, Vishnu B. Unitan.
Hello, am I
from St. G.S. Medical College, Maharashtra, you are there.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Can you turn on your video?
Okay. Is my presentation visible?
Presentation is visible, yeah. So we're going to present on the brewing caregiver burden, cross-section study of caregiver burden in alcohol use disorder. Yeah. You can switch on your video, right?
Yes, just a second. Am I visible? Hello, am I visible?
No. I think no.
Yes, you are.
Oh, yeah. You can start your presentation. Slides are visible.
Thank you, organizers. Welcome, respected judges and fellow researchers. I am Vishnu Unnithan, presenting caregiver burden in primary caregivers of patients with alcohol use disorder. The latest national survey conducted by AIIMS finds alcohol to be the commonest psychoactive substance used by Indians. However, it may develop into alcohol use disorder, which by 2050 in India alone is predicted to cause a loss of rupees 98 lakh crores. Alcohol is a situational disinhibitor, and the resulting neurobehavioral changes cause economic burden, which chiefly impact the family of the patient. So why is this study needed? We identified a gap in literature on alcohol use disorder. No studies are available correlating the caregiver burden among all caregiver subsets with variables of alcohol use disorder. Our aim was to assess the prevalence of primary caregiver burden. We express our further aims as two hypotheses, analyzing the relation of caregiver burden with first, the caregiver's socio-demographic variables, namely the education, employment, and socioeconomic class. And second, proposing a positive correlation with variables of alcohol consumption, that is quantity, expenditure, and years of consumption, which is a two-tailed hypothesis. Cochrane's formula was used to calculate the sample size. After ethics approval, over 2 months, we interviewed 80 adult primary caregivers of patients with alcohol use disorder diagnosed as per DSM-5 criteria by purposive sampling technique. We excluded patients having other comorbidities. We made use of a structured case record form and the 22-item caregiver burden scale. Chi-square values and Pearson's correlation were calculated. Coming to the results, all patients were males, majority spent between 100 to 200 rupees over 10 to 20 years on 1 to 2 quarters of alcohol daily. Here are the mean and standard deviation values. Almost all caregivers were educated housewives from the middle three socioeconomic classes. There was a 95% prevalence of caregiver burden, with most experiencing moderate to severe burden. Our p-values indicated that the association of caregiver burden with socioeconomic class, educational status, and employment status was statistically insignificant. Significant positive correlation was obtained of caregiver burden with monthly alcohol expenditure and quantity of alcohol consumed. The correlation with years of alcohol consumption was not significant. Here is a graphical representation of our significant correlations. Thus, we rejected the first hypothesis and accepted a part of the second hypothesis. So let's discuss our results stepwise. The AIMS data states that men are 17 times more likely to consume alcohol, matching our results where all patients were males. Culturally, females have been demarcated as the caregivers, which was echoed in our study. Thus, representation from all possible backgrounds indicating that alcohol use disorder is not an isolated issue, but rather an international health concern plaguing all. The high prevalence of caregiver burden can be attributed to the development of a vicious cycle where high burden leads to poor caregiver support, which demotivates the patient from his de-addiction regime, causing increased use, resulting in severe negative effects like domestic violence, which again causes high caregiver burden. Though studies suggest that the poor, the illiterate, and the unemployed have a higher incidence of alcohol use disorder, caregiver burden in them may be mitigated due to higher perceived social support, while other caregivers have to deal with additional pressures of work and also take efforts to maintain social standing. Thus, the eventual caregiver burden is the same on both ends of the spectrum. A second finding is that the more alcohol the patient currently consumes, higher is the caregiver burden. This due to the vicious cycle already explained. Caregivers of patients with shorter history initially actively try to change these new disruptive habits, but later they develop a degree of acceptance towards these behaviors. Thus, they may feel the same burden as caregivers of chronic patients. The chief strength of our study was its focus on all primary caregiver subsets of patients of alcohol use disorder. However, the study was carried out at a single center, thus restricting its generalizability. We recommend that large-scale interventional studies need to be carried out. Hence, we concluded there is a high prevalence of caregiver burden. There's no statistical correlation with caregivers' educational status, socioeconomic class, employment, or years of alcohol consumption, but is positively correlated with quantity of alcohol consumed daily and monthly alcohol expenditure. Currently, de-addiction protocols exist only for patients. We propose the development of treatment interventions specifically directed to reducing caregiver burden. These include the creation of caregiver support groups and spreading awareness about caregiver burden in alcohol use disorder. Primary caregiver needs to be counseled and psychoeducated to overcome maladaptive coping mechanisms and effectively combat alcohol use disorder. These are the references quoted. I thank everyone for their patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Vishnu. And let's go for the question and answer session. And to start with, Dr. Arun Kumar, do you have any questions, sir?
Yeah, I have no questions. Thank you.
Dr. Sudhakar?
Yeah, no questions, but just a comment. Nice, good presentation, and I enjoy GSS canteen food. So it's nice to see somebody presenting from our next building. Good presentation.
Then Dr. Rodrigo, sir?
No comments. Very good presentation.
Okay. So thank you, Vishnu. Can go to your presentation. So all the presentation for the day has been, for the session has been over. And thank you, judges, and thank you, participants. It's an awesome session. And I congratulate all the participants. And I'll hand over to Anna for the vote of thanks and details regarding the results. Anna?
Thank you, Kaushik. We come towards the end of this wonderful session. We'd like to thank Dr. Rodrigo Neto, Dr. Digumati V.S. Sudhakar, and Dr. Arun Kumar Annamalai for their time and patience. And we'd like to thank all the participants for having chosen MedInvade as a platform to share their brilliant work. The results will be announced during the closing ceremony on 27th September 2020. But for now, good night and have a great time at the rest of the conference. I'd like to ask the judges and the participants to stay back to take a group photo, and then we can leave.